zip through some of the highlights of the past year and then say a little bit about where we see EcoLogos heading in the future, particularly in the coming year. So under achievements, and these are not in any particular order at all, it just they kind of fit together this way, but we did a total recreation of our website in the past year. I want to thank especially Ronnie and Bob for spearheading that whole project. And also I want to thank one other person, Monica from Vancouver. That's great. It's wonderful just to think of somebody on the other side of the continent, contributing in that way. Since that website came up, we get two or three requests to be put on our mailing list every single day, generated purely from that website. And we didn't, we never had anything like that happen before. So I think the website is doing what it's supposed to do. I also want to mention, if you're following this, our e-list. Not a very sexy kind of thing, but I'll tell you, we tend this list. There's work on this list, again, every single day. And that list is now up well over 1,200 people. It's a very clean list. And what's important about that is that there's a significant leveraging power in that. And we use that leveraging power. One place where we used it a lot in the past year was to promote the Water Docs film series. And so I'm sure many of you around the table were treated to our rather regular e-blasts about Water Docs. One of the other things that we used that e-list for in particular was to support the Stop the Mega Quarry project, which Carl is going to tell us more about a little bit later. Anyway, Water Docs was six screenings between World Water Day and Earth Day, March 22nd to April 22nd. And we did it as a pilot, and it totally outstripped our expectations in all respects. Quite a few hundred people who had a wonderful opportunity to think about, to reflect on both the wonder of water and also the ways that we humans are tempting its fragility here in Canada and elsewhere. Special thanks to Melanie, who was our fearless leader throughout that whole process, and we absolutely loved the outcome. But again, it was also very much particularly a design team effort, and also volunteers. I'm going to say a word about that in a minute. And that's a regional campaign to engage citizens in water stewardship. The five programs were all developed over the course of the year that we're celebrating tonight. One of the programs, which is Water Docs, was piloted on the ground. And now we're going to go into piloting all five initiatives in the coming year in a test region. And so to that end, on World Water Day, Ian, on our behalf, signed an agreement with Sir Sanford Fleming College to partner with us to pilot the five initiatives of Water Live in the region where that college is located in central Ontario. If you if you were to value the donated professional services that we received in the past year, a very conservative estimation of that would be $30,000. They don't honor that in an audit, unfortunately, but if you take that into account, then we more than doubled our income in the past year. And the new and our New Year's appeal, which most of you will know we do every December and January, was the most successful appeal we ever had, reaching a goal of 50,000. And then finally, I'd like to, under achievements, I'd like to talk about volunteers. Again, we had a far greater participation by volunteers in the past year than we ever had before. And I want to thank Jennifer. Stand up. This lady is fantastic with volunteers and getting them lined up and organized and really terrific. So thank you, Jennifer, and everybody. So what we're hoping to do with Water Docs is to develop that into an international juried competition on water-themed film and also media. We don't think that we can make that happen in 1 year. It might take 2 years, might take 3 years, but that's our goal. And we have a nice start, I think, because we have formed a partnership already with Voices from the Waters International Film Festival out of Bangalore, India. So that's a wonderful access between here and there on which to build an international program. Here, I got a phone call from a gentleman by the name of Howard Berry, who had been in the congregation that day, and who had a very interesting idea. And that is that Howard, who is the principal and CEO of a company called TerraQuest Incorporated, whose primary business is a geological mapping, would you say? Aerial geological mapping. And provides service mostly to mining concerns and as well as nations, and works all around the world. But his company has also developed a patented technology for acid rock drainage. Acid rock drainage is without a doubt the most significant polluting dynamic done by mining, and is a problem largely without a really effective solution. So Howard suggested the possibility of contributing that technology to EcoLogos. And EcoLogos would then enter into a relationship with a company that could develop that and sell that, and we would have an income stream from royalties. So it's an amazing opportunity, and I wanted you to meet Howard. Many of you have, but to meet Howard and to have him tell us more about this in terms of the technology and the opportunity that exists.
But no, actually, I'm thrilled to be able to present this technology to the group, because I think it's a reflection of the way technology and also the way business is going to be done in the not too distant future, particularly with the wonderful advent of younger people coming on and seeing the importance of ecological emissions and making a difference. So the agenda is the who, what, when, where, and why of the technology, and to describe it, and also describe the market size of it, and then to look at it from a commercialization point of view. And I might add that I've been working on this for about 8 years, and we got our patent, we got our U.S. patent in 2004, and then we were very close to having it commercialized in 2007 when the bottom of the market dropped out, and it's been very difficult to get some support after that one. When we started the company, the mission statement was to be a global leader in the innovative technologies to provide cost-effective and hazardous environmental impact technologies.
From the great heart to begin with, and beautiful food, and if I have a request before I say anything about the mega quarry, please, Catherine, be kind to me. Don't make the Highlands Company's application known as Carl's case. Got that one out of the way. I'm always humbled by how many people and groups are involved in this issue. And two things come to mind. The mega quarry case, somehow, the proposal seems to be the lightning rod that finds ways to attract all kinds of important issues, from local food to preservation of farmland to water issues, and how this one application has combined so many concerns and has put some solutions right at our fingertips. Case in point, if we can, through the Aggregate Resources Act review, focus some attention at government and bureaucratic level to protect prime farmland from industrial excavation, we have solved the source water issue that is connected to this. You guys are all familiar with the numbers, and I don't have to, you know, tell you those. A real key for us is to ask questions that we know we can solicit a yes from. You know, that's a really interesting sort of approach to lobbying. And there's a unique opportunity centered around this proposal, and that is because of so many bright people engaged in this, we got to this before a license was ever granted. Most popular movements that you see happen, they happen because a license has already been granted to do something, and now we're taking opposition with someone else's position. In the mega quarry case, so far, it's following the rules, government is following the rules of a proposal, and we have some real influence on the decision making. In other words, you don't have to go to a minister and say you made a mistake granting the license. That's a really, you know, if you think about how you solve problems, if you have to get the decision maker to admit he made a wrong decision, that's way harder than influencing the original decision. So we're really fortunate to be in the game where we're in. And I appreciate, and it's one of my most humbling experiences, on how many people and groups are involved, and I always struggle in finding ways to say thank you, because you're sure going to miss someone. It likely take me 24 hours to walk through a list of people that I know who have given so generously in this 100% volunteer effort, taken the Baupost hedge fund, known, and I can say this now legally, referred to in a New York courtroom as a vulture fund by a lawyer, so I'm just reporting. Boy, this is, you know. We're going to take them absolutely to task with their proposal.
I have to bring greetings from the mayor. It's supposed to be his meeting tonight, and he was double booked, so he asked me to fill in. And this is interesting because I started community advocacy all the way back in the 80s when I worked with the Seton Community Group, which was People or Planes before that, and fought the Pickering Airport. So what are we, 40 years later? And it'll probably be realized in the next 10 years, but they did a pretty good job of staving it off for 40 years. The other one was when I was with the Federation of Ontario Cottages Association, we fought Dombind. And if you don't know what Dombind Dombind is the liquor that's left after you recycle old corrugated cardboard and you pulp wood. And they used to use it as a road binder in cottage country.
Right.
And it was water soluble, so it flowed off the roads and it flowed into people's dug wells and it flowed into water courses and whatnot. And there was absolutely nothing wrong with it. We've used it for years. No heavy metals in it. What heavy metals are you testing for? Well, they tested for everything except mercury. Guess what?
Yeah, right.
So when we asked to have the mercury test done, there was all kinds of reasons why that couldn't be done. Turns out that there happened to be appreciable levels of mercury. Small. It was a small win, but it was one that we did win in about the late 90s. But there was Sierra Legal Defense Fund was involved in that and a few other rather prominent environmental organizations, but that was when we were known as the tree huggers and environmentalists and whatnot. And I'm the director of economic development, and does anybody know what economic development does? Well, it's supposed to bring in business, but in rural Ontario, most of our business is going to come from entrepreneurs. So we look for a lot of people who are innovative, who are looking for a quality of life, because we're not smokestack chasing anymore. That's passé. So one of the reasons that the city of Porth Lakes, does anybody know where the city of Porth Lakes is?
I do.
Do you? Do you know what it used to be called?
Yeah, either
one. A couple of different things.
It used to be called Victoria County. And there was 16 townships and small communities and whatnot. And one of our counselors now wants us to have a big sign up, 401-35-115 interchange that says City of Porth Lakes, which is great if you live there. Not so great if you don't live there and you're trying to figure out where Lindsay, Fenland Falls, Bob.
I know. I wish they would.
All these communities that, you know, City of Porth Lakes is 3,000 square kilometers. There's 41 communities in it, and there's 250 lakes and rivers. And that 250 lakes and rivers is part of the Trans-Severn Waterways as well. Balsam Lake Provincial Park. Anybody know where Balsam Lake Provincial Park is?
I do.
About 125,000 visitors a year. It's one of our biggest attractions that we have in that area. It's huge. We also have a very strong seasonal population, about 30, 35,000 people. And what are they looking for? They're looking for a waterfront property that offers recreation. We also have 1.5 million people who come into the community every year to take advantage of those recreational opportunities, primarily around water. So what happens when you have blue-green algae in Sturgeon Lake, and Pigeon Lake, and 4 Mile Lake? Blue-green algae is really not fun. It's dangerous. Even if you boil it, you still can't drink the water. It's still toxic. So when you're talking about an economy that has for the last 200 years been built on water and continues to rely heavily on water for its two key economic drivers, one of which is agriculture and the other one's tourism. And out of that 303,000 square kilometers, at the south end, we have a very strong agricultural presence.